So today I'm going to be talking about Kantsevich formality theorem. And no? No, it's Kantsevich formality theorem, but proof by Tamarkin. Okay. I'm going to be talking about Kantsevich, what Kantsevich showed, and what Tamarkin showed in an even nicer way after him. So I'll just start by then. So, theorem. Which is called Kantsevich formality theorem, states that there exists an L infinity quasi isomorphism from T poly, right. Let M be a manifold there exists an L infinity quasi isomorphism from T poly of M to D poly of M. Great. If you understand what all of this means, maybe you can skip the first half of my talk. Because what I'll be my idea is to explain so everything that's written here in the beginning. So a manifold, I think I don't need to explain. Sorry? Smooth, yes. But I think it doesn't need to be orientable. No, it's just any manifold. Okay. Now, given a manifold, what do I call T poly? These are the multi differential vector fields, multi vector fields, whatever. And there's always this problem with Latin Greek roots, so I call them multi, but they're poly. Who cares? I think this started with some because Russian people were the first ones to start talking about this, and they started calling it poly, and then we like better to call them multi, but this notation was taken. Anyway, you know what's the, you know, given a manifold, we call TM. TM is the sheaf, or let's just say the global vector fields on M, and this is a C infinity ring, right? The functions naturally act on this, and we define T poly as being sorry? I'm sorry? Yes.
You can multiply the coupling by functions, yes, what you said about
No, it's I said over the ring of functions, or maybe I said it incorrectly, and thank you for the remark. So anyway, T poly is the wedge product, the exterior algebra of this TM over this ring C infinity of M. So I mean, I think you know what this is, right? So this is a graded vector space a priori, which in degree zero you have C infinity of M. Then in degree one, you have Tm. Then in degree two, you have Tm wedge Tm until you get to wedge n times of Tm, where this is the dimension of your manifold. Fine. So this is what Tipoli is. And I think in Michele's talk we saw that this comes with this is not just a vector space, this comes with a Lie bracket. So you know that Tm is a Lie algebra using the, how do you call it, the commutator of vector fields. The commutator of vector fields, and this comes with a product, which is the natural problem, the product. I mean, probably everyone knows what at least the Rum complex is, and the product is just taking the wedge product of forms. Here it's the dual thing. You wedge vector fields, and there is an anti-symmetric product which is wedge. Now, and in Tipoli there is this, and the point is that this bracket can be extended to the whole Tipoli by B derivations. So this implies that Tipoli with this and this, where we define, say, just for example, what do I mean? If you take two vector fields and I wedge them times something else, this should be x wedge y else plus or minus x else y. Probably here there's also a plus or minus. And I mean, in degree zero, we have the C infinity functions. So just say that XF is X of F. So this Lie bracket on this space is what, so this extension of the normal Lie bracket is what people call the Schouten Neinhaus bracket, or so my Dutch friends tell me. Apparently, no one is able to pronounce this correctly, so why try? Good. So we understand what's the left side of this equality is. Where? Yes. I did forget the wedge. Now, so when you have a structure of so what you see from here is that if you take the, okay, so by convention, let's say that this is in degree minus one, okay? And in that case, this is in degree minus two, and this is in degree minus dimension of n. In that case, this we have, so what we have is, we have a leaf bracket, the product, and the product sends something of degree m, the product of something of degree m with something of degree n is of degree m plus n, right? So for obvious reasons. And so the product has degree zero. But if we take, for instance, two vector fields and we take their bracket, we don't, it's something of degree minus one and something of degree minus one, you don't obtain something of degree minus two. We still obtain something of degree minus one. So the bracket has degree. The bracket has degree one, but I wanted the bracket to have degree minus one. So in that case, great, simple. A Lie bracket of degree minus one. So far, so good? Do we know everything that there is to know about this T-poly? Good. That's exactly what we want to do. So what will I explain next? Let's explain what is D-poly. And for this, and for this, I will start with something that was already talked about in this seminar by Linard, and I don't know if anyone else talked about this, but which is the Hochschild complex, or rather, there are two Hochschild complexes. One is sort of a homological Hochschild complex, and the other one is a cohomological Hochschild complex. So let me just make this explicit by saying the Hochschild cohomological, co-complex, co-Hochschild, if you want. Let A be an associative algebra. We define its Hochschild complex C, and we write C of A as being, by definition, home. So the bullet is in is the degree. So these are essentially morphisms from a tensor power of A to A. Co-complex. This, hence the bullet here and not downstairs, right? So this is by definition the Hochschild. At least, whatever, a complex and a co-complex are similar structures, right? yes. So let me then tell you something about Hochschild, if I find. Yes, so it's by definition this. Okay, a priori this is just a vector space, right? And instead of justifying why is this a complex, I will justify something completely different. I'll say why is this a Lie algebra. So we define a bracket on C of A by, so what can you do? We take F, so F is a map from say A tensor N to A, and then I have G, also a map, but from A tensor M to A, and I want to produce something out of this. So I define the Lie bracket of F and G. To be a function from A tensor N plus M minus 1. And I mean, this minus 1 is here more or less for the same reason that this minus 1 will be here. We'll get there. To A by FG. Good. This minus, so everything understands what I wrote, right? Everyone? Of course not. I mean, this is what people usually call the braces operation. So what does this mean? This is some sort of composition. So say where F G, this should be something that gets a bunch of inputs. Let's just call them A1, AN plus M minus 1. And what we can do this, I mean, the idea is we make some sort of composition here. But how can we compose? It's not like, unless F is of degree 1, it's not like we can plug G inside of F just like that. But like, if F is of degree 1, we want to do this. But let's say F is has more input. So like F has, in this case, N slots. And I can put G inside each of these slots. So so this is exactly what we do. So we put G in the first slot. So until A1 until AM. And then we fill out the rest with the rest of the A's. But then we can do the following. We can put instead A1 here and insert G on the second slot. A2, AN. So this is M. AM plus 1. And then we continue. So something. So the plus minus. Yes, the plus minus, you use the usual Kozul sign rules, but there is a minor. Oh, okay. You don't know what I'm talking about? Okay, sorry. Then. Yes, and that's what I write in my papers, and I never write any sign again in my life. But no, when I say in France, everyone was always saying the Kozul sign rules, and I got used to this witchcraft. So I mean, when you have two forms, omega and alpha or whatever, when you have two anything, and you commute them, this should be minus 1 to the power of the degrees alpha omega, right? And this is what I call Kozul. But here there is a minor detail like here, because this bracket is supposed to have degree minus 1. So in fact here I think it's supposed to be omega minus 1, alpha minus 1. But let's not care much about this. Life is modulo 2. Yes, which means that. So I mean, I had a plan for this talk. People in the audience will not see this, but this is my plan of rigor for this talk. So I mean, with what? No, this is still the introduction. I'm still explaining more or less what's going in the theorem. Yes, the graph was made. The point is that the graph was made when I was still in the introduction, so it's not very rigorous graph, right? Fair enough. Okay, but the point is this is the only reasonable way to compose things. So we compose it in every possible way, but then you want this to be a graded Lie bracket, and then you put the signs that you want. this is the Lie bracket that we have, and I mean, why is this of degree minus one? Because by plugging G in here, we're killing one possible slot, and that's why this is of degree minus one. Now, yes, so I take these A1s, this order, and I have exactly n plus m or plus or minus one terms here, which, so I don't reorder, I just plug, first I plug G in, and then the A's go in with no possible shuffling. Okay. This is the Lie bracket for the Hochschild cohomological complex of an associative algebra. And why is it a complex? So I defined first the Lie bracket because it's much easier to see what the complex is from after defining the Lie bracket. So if I give you an associative Lie algebra, can you think of some distinguished element in HOM of this to HOM of some tensor product to A? I mean, there is. That's a very good one, but the associator is made out of something even more basic, right? Yes, and the associator first of all is zero, but the point is that the associator is made out of something much more basic, which is the multiplication of the algebra. So if you have mu, the multiplication from A2 to A, I mean, this tells us that mu is in C1 of AA, right? How did I define this? Because I defined this like this. Okay, then it's a C2. And what you can see is that what's a mu bracket with itself. So first note that this is not automatically zero because this is a graded Lie bracket, and we're in the wrong degree. I mean, in all degrees, this commutator will always be zero. But the point is that in this case, this will be say on A B C. This will be essentially ABC minus ABC. I mean, what these are the two possible ways I can put mu inside mu. And the algebra is associative, so this is zero. So we know that this is zero. Now, of course, I didn't show that this makes exactly all the algebra special, but it is. It's easy to see that it's anti-symmetric, and it's also not very difficult to see that it satisfies Jacobi. So it's essentially just really a notation issue, but it's, I mean, there's nothing deep. It's very checkable. So, yes. So to be completely rigorous, since it shifts by one, so if you consider the complex shifted by one, so instead of defining C dot as being the morphism from the tensor product to A, it's like the tensor product minus one. That's a genuine Lie algebra. Otherwise, we just say that this is a Lie algebra shifted by one. But in any case, the big point here is that it satisfies the Jacobi identity.
It's because it's a commutator vector field.
What?
The real reason is because it's a commutator vector
field. Yes, if you don't, but I mean, here I'm doing it for any algebra, right? So you're saying in a context of a manifold, it's
No, I'm saying that you can assemble all the guys. You have an isomorphism of C dot AA with the co-derivations of something, and there this is the algebra by commutator.
Yes. Oh, okay, that's also a good explanation, I guess, a more conceptual one. But in any case, we agree for whichever reason you want to choose that this is a Lie algebra, it satisfies Jacobi. So the fact that it satisfies Jacobi means that, and that mu is zero, means that if I take some guy A and I plug and I take twice, so at mu is just it's what I call this. So if I do this twice to this guy by Jacobi, this should be something like, again, up to some plus or minus that will depend on the degree of the guy we take here. So this will be.
So A is not an element of A, or
is A? I should call it F. So F is some element here. So let F in C dot of AA. Good. So you apply Jacobi, and you is the multiplication. Yeah. So this is something like this plus or minus, so let's say it's really a minus because you check this. I mean, what are the possibilities? You wrote this cyclically, and you get, sorry, F mu. Okay, it's a plus or minus, but the point is, okay, this guy will be equal to zero from our previous calculation, and this will be exactly the symmetric of that one. So somehow this will be equivalent to two times mu f, because I mean here you use the anti-symmetry, equals zero, and I mean, so what we conclude from here is that at mu square is equal to zero. And we say, or we define, no, whatever. We define D to be this add mu, which is something that goes from. Yes. So, we assume, as good mathematical physicists, that everything is of characteristic zero. Okay. No, actually, this is important because then we'll be taking Cobar constructions, and they only behave nicely in characteristic zero.
Well, they also behave nicely in characteristic P up to degree P.
Okay. I don't call that behaving nicely, okay? And I mean, mu is of degree two, but the bracket is of degree minus one. So when you apply mu to something, you get something of degree one bigger. So this is a differential. Moreover, because of Jacobi also, it satisfies the following property. So moreover, D of F G is D of F G plus or minus F DG, which is what we call, I don't know, I mean, this is a Leibniz property, and this is very easy to see, because if you see this as plugging mu into something, this turns out just being equivalent to the Jacobi identity. So okay, so this is very nice. It has a differential, it's a complex, great. How does this relate to all this story that I was talking about before with this formality theorem? So it's related to this dipole. So this plus or minus here should be no, you don't see that yes, it's degree of probably minus one to the degree of f minus one, because the idea is sort of d is jumping over not only over f but the comma. I mean of course this makes no sense, but it's a nice heuristic way to see why you should get yes, exactly, because the bracket has degree minus one, so you get also a minus one extra factor. Yes. Oh yeah. Also, yeah, because you're commuting mu with a comma, sort of. So you get a degree of one times one. Ah yeah, but bracket with mu has degree one. That's the whole point. Forget about mu. This is a d. D has degree one, yes. And F has degree F, and comma has degree one. So mu jumps over F, you get degree, you get the minus one to the power F, jumps over the comma, you get the minus one. So now let's get to this dipole. Dipole is the set, the algebra, the what's dipole as a structure? Let's say dipole is the vector space of multi-poly, let's use poly now for a change, poly differential operators in M. And what does this mean? It means that so dipole is some subset of HOM of C infinity tensor N. So it's some subset of maps from C infinity of M to C, of this, of poly differential operators, which means that Sorry? Yes. That so that locally look like some derivations, some differentials. So with some say coefficients. So say as an example to see what's this. So you could take, for instance, the something from C infinity to C infinity, which would be, say, something that sends x. Sorry, I don't know. D over dx, d over dy, or something. So it's all things that locally look like this. I don't know if I'm making myself clear enough. Yeah. but the point is, yeah, you're taking two functions. You plug one here, you plug the other one in the other place, and yeah, at the end you multiply them. But the point is, I mean, this is what we just before were calling the Hochschild complex of C infinity of M. The fact that we write the algebra twice is that we look like with values in the algebra. This is a bit more general than what I'm doing here. But so it's this, and the point is that the differential on the Hochschild complex restricts to the poly, and also the Lie bracket differential, and this Lie bracket restrict. And it's very easy to see this. If you compose two differential operators to multi-differential, oh, you'll get a multi-differential operator. I mean, so you're taking derivatives of derivatives. And if you multiply differential operators, which is what the differential is doing, you still get differential operators. So it's quite natural to see that this is a sub-differential graded Lie algebra, right? So very good. We understand now what we understand from here. Do we understand everything? Not yet. So now we understand what t-poly is. Now we also understand what t-poly is, right? And do we know what a quasi-isomorphism is? Let me start erasing things. I mean, I don't want to erase this right away because I will need this upper part. Very good. So just for completeness, a map F from C to D of complexes. So when I say map of complexes, it's a map that commutes with a differential. Yes. Yes. I think there is some more intrinsic definition for. Yes, I'm pretty sure there is. I already saw it, but it looks a bit complicated. And I think, I mean, this is clearly the way you perceive things. But yes, there is a way to define them globally without going to local charts, I think. Yeah. So a map is a quasi-isomorphism if so a map of complexes induces some mapping homology or cohomology, and we say that something is a quasi-isomorphism if this map, the induced map, is an isomorphism. And now the whole point of this is, so why do we call this the formality theorem? So you say that something is formal if, so let's say definition. An algebra, I don't know, like of any kind, whether it's Lie algebra, normal algebra, just a vector space, I mean, an algebraic structure. Not one, but two of them, two algebras, I'm saying nonsense. Two is good. Two is a good number. So we say that two algebras are quasi-isomorphic. So the natural definition that you would say for two algebras to be quasi-isomorphic is to say that there is a map like this on the two algebras that induces a quasi-isomorphism in homology. The problem is that in general, you just because you have a quasi-isomorphism in this direction doesn't mean that you have a quasi-isomorphism in the other direction. It's not the same that happens with isomorphisms. So it's not like all quasi-isomorphisms can be inverted. So in fact, you say that two things are quasi-isomorphic if they're isomorphic in the respective homotopy category. In practice, what this means is that you say that C and D are quasi-isomorphic if you can somehow connect C to E, and then you connect E to F, and then with some F to G, and then like this, such that all of these maps are quasi-isomorphic, quasi-isomorphisms. Yes, exactly. Okay. Yeah, essentially that's what I'm saying. It's not symmetric as an equivalence relation. So yes, if you want to think of this as equivalence relation, the quasi-isomorphism being quasi-isomorphic means you take the completion in the completion, you extend this to an equivalence relation, that's what you get. Anyway, why am I saying this? Because I just want to justify why the word formal is here, is there. So also definition. Something is formal if it is quasi-isomorphic, to its cohomology. What's the question?
DG algebras, I mean algebras with the enriching complexes with the D. A priori, we don't know why there's a complex when you have an algebra.
So you said you take.
Sorry, yeah, algebra. Two algebras with some differential. If you so yes, they are complexes. Yes, I have a complex. Sorry, I said algebras. I meant DG algebras, or DG stands for differential grading. Graded. Yes. So the point is, whenever you have a structure, some structure with some differential, then you can make, so which is in particular a complex, And then you have a micro complexes, yeah. Then, yeah, this is the right setting to talk about this. So, and this is what formal means. Formal means that it's quasi-isomorphic to its homology. And then the point is, we come here to this Kuntsevich business, and this is a complex with this Hochschild differential. And this is a complex with an even nicer differential, which is the zero differential. So the fact that you say that these two things are quasi-isomorphic, I mean, in particular, means that this is the homology of this guy. So if we show that there is a map of Lie infinity, we'll get there. From here to there, that's a quasi-isomorphism. In particular, it means that this map is a sort of a formality map. It gives you this sort of zigzag of quasi-isomorphisms. Now, did I explain everything from here except for the L infinity part? I think so. Yeah, just a bit more of introduction. Yes. When we have a structure like this with the Lie bracket and the product, so also definition, if we have some Lie bracket of degree minus one and some product of degree zero, and with the Leibniz property.
No.
The point is, their homology is the same, but there is a very big difference between being a quasi-isomorphic. I mean, there is actually a map inducing a quasi-isomorphism in homology, because the whole point is, if you forget about the fact that these are some algebras with some structure, if they were just differential graded vector spaces, everything having the same homology is equivalent to saying that there is some map inducing a quasi-isomorphism. That's okay. But the whole point of this is that you want to respect some structure that they have. And that's essentially why I'm talking about these Lie brackets and stuff, because this is the good structure that we want to preserve. Yes, exactly.
And also, there's one thing I want to say, which took me a long time, is that you have a parameter map from the cocycles to the cohomology. So, but you have more than just the cocycles, you have the rest. You don't know how to go from the rest of the complex, which are not necessarily cocycles, to the cohomology. So, that's also interesting.
Yeah, well, yeah, sometimes.
Yeah. Also, one more thing. The homology itself. Yes. But so the fact that you have this compatibility with the differential and the Lie bracket, for instance, tells you that the homology itself has more structure than just the structure of a vector space. The homology itself inherits this Lie bracket. So the homology of Dipoli comes in fact with a Lie bracket a priori, and this Lie bracket will actually coincide with the Lie bracket that we define on Dipoli in the Schouten-Einhaus. Yes, because Tipoli, by this theorem that is the whole point of this talk, is the cohomology of the other guy. And so yeah, even if they had the same homology a priori, you wouldn't know that you wouldn't even know if the homology has the same Lie algebra structure, right? And the fact that you have this morphism, which induces a quasi-isomorphism, tells also that this map induces a quasi-isomorphism, an isomorphism at the level of Lie algebras. Yeah, somehow. But what you would say? What if
the change of quasi-iso was just here to motivate the main formality theorem? Right. Actually, we don't work with change of in the category of GELA. We really work in the category. We don't need to change here.
Yeah. And I mean, we'll get to this L infinity, but usually in all sorts of questions like this, the correct question is like how do things behave up to homotopy. Sure. Yeah, actually I can still write here. Yes. If there is a geometric interpretation of this result, Yael, help me. Leonard is asking me, what's the geometric interpretation of this result?
So you have two vector fields on the right and on the left, and you have a map which commutes with these vector fields, and so it will send the zeros to the zeros, and the zeros would be the Markov elements, and that's what we want. Because the Markov element on the left, they are the Poisson structures, and the Markov on the right, they are the deformations.
These two guys are Lie algebras. We could try to find a Lie quasi-isomorphism from one of them, so a quasi-isomorphism of Lie algebras, but that's not what we do. We find a quasi-isomorphism of some L infinity algebras, which is some sort of generalization of Lie algebras, and in fact we even do better than this. We, as I was saying, this is what, when you have, yeah, what I was saying exactly here is whenever we have this property, we say that an algebra that satisfies these properties have a Gerstenhaber algebra. Now, as we saw, that guy comes with a Gerstenhaber structure. That guy doesn't, a priori. However, theorem by guess who? Gerstenhaber itself. The Hochschild. Cohomology of an associative algebra A. So Hochschild cohomology is just a cohomology of the Hochschild complex. Has Gerstenhaber. What's algebra structure? And I mean, what do you need to have the Gerstenhaber algebra structure? You have the Lie bracket. The Lie bracket, we already have it. It's of degree minus one. Great. We also need the wedge product. And the wedge product here, I mean, it's also very natural to define the wedge product on the level of cochains, which is, so if you take two guys, F and F of degree n and g. So let's say degree of this is a and degree of this is b. So this one has a inputs, this one has b inputs. One very natural thing to do is I mean, if you want to create some F wedge G and put A plus B outputs, sorry, inputs. Okay, bad notation. Is to do something very silly, which is you put the first A in F, you put the other B in G. So A plus one. So I don't know if I'm writing very clearly. So which wedge? I don't know what you're talking about. I mean, you plug the whatever you can put here and whatever you can put here, keeping the order. So this is not a sum; it's just one product. And then you multiply them, and you get this. I mean, no, I'm defining this on the level of the chains. And the point is, I mean, everything goes wrong with this. In particular, I mean, it's very clear that this is not even commutative or anti-commutative. No, we don't want to skew symmetrize, because also the fact you also want to have this Leibniz property, right? So I mean, you can try to make things go well; they won't. The cool thing is that by defining this like this, I mean, the Hochschild cohomology will admit a well-behaved associative algebra structure, and I mean, the representative for the wedge product will be something like this. Yes, it's not commutative, but it's very associative. But you don't have the Leibniz property. This fails very heavily, I think. And so what we're going to do is we're gonna put some nice structure on these two guys using also this Gestenhaber stuff. And for this, let's do a detour on homology. So I'm 1 hour through, right, with the talk. I'm screwed. Sorry? Oh, yes. Oh, yes, it will. Ah, but it's so sad. So what's my idea for this? I'm not going to prove this theorem. This theorem is very long to prove. I'm going to introduce what are the main tools that are important to prove this theorem. Also, it's important to say what's difficult and what's not. One thing that might sound difficult, and actually it's not so complicated, is to see that actually, I mean, this is related to Thomas' remark. Actually, it's not so complicated to see that dipoli, that its homology with this differential is something isomorphic to t-poly. I mean, at least age, it's very easy to do by hand, to compute by hand the fact that h1 of the complex are the derivations of some algebra. To do the general case, you can use some spectral sequence argument. But I mean, the point is, this is not the main difficulty of the question. Also, the fact that we're on a manifold, let's forget. Let's oversimplify things as much as we can. And our manifold is Rn, and I mean, it's not even C-infinity functions. We do it with polynomial functions. So, we can do this for the algebra of polynomial functions, and the whole point is you can do this. Yes. So now I'm introducing the necessary tools to solve this formality problem. And what I'm saying is it's not complicated the part to compute the homology. This is very doable. Yes, exactly. Having the compatible structure is hard. Now, what's also not difficult, I mean, first you don't do it already in a general manifold. So you do it in Rn, and you don't consider its infinity functions. You consider just a polynomial algebra, and then from here to to the general C-infinity functions on a manifold. There you can sort of glue things together because you're doing it locally, then you glue things together with some connection. I don't know exactly the details about that, but I think that's also not the main part of this issue. So the whole thing is I mean, at least with Tamarkin's approach, this passes by even doing better, constructing some sort of Gerstenhaber quasi-isomorphism between these two guys. What's the problem? This is a Gerstenhaber algebra, but this is not. So for this, he puts Gerstenhaber infinity structure on this. And this is what's complicated about all of these proofs. So I'll introduce for this, because the language of operads is it's very practical to deal with all of this. And I will be talking a bit about operads, and let's see how the rigor progresses over everything. So, operads. Good. Yes, it's even better. Yes. So, this was not the first proof. The first proof is naturally due to Kontsevich, and Kontsevich actually gives a very explicit morphism, but just L infinity. And I mean, there it's related to these integrals that you were talking last week. Anyway, so what's an operad? What's the idea of an operad? An operad is something that encodes algebra, some type of algebras. So there are many types of algebras. There is the stupid algebra, which is a vector space with no structure. Good. We don't care about this. There are associative algebras. What do you have when you have an associative algebra in general? So not a specific associative algebra, but if you have a general associative algebra, you have like this mu that I was talking about. You have the multiplication. And the multiplication is something with two inputs and one output. And I denote this by this. Seems nice, right? These two legs means that I input two guys here, and this one leg means like two guys come in, one comes out. This is what mu does. And I mean, let's put here a one in the two, just to say that the first input goes to this leg and the second input goes to the other leg. Now, there are other kinds of algebras. There is like, okay, so this is associative algebras. These are Lie algebras. Lie algebra comes with a Lie bracket. What's a Lie bracket? The Lie bracket is something that also looks like this. It's something that receives one input and gets out two outputs and produces two outputs. These two so far look fairly the same. What's the difference? I mean, you could also say, like in commutative algebra, it's also the same thing. The difference is the whole point is that in most algebraic structures, you have some notion of symmetry, like what happens when you permute variables somehow. Not really in associative algebra. You sort of have two completely different multiplications, no axioms relating what happens with A cross weight A times B and B times A. However, in commutative algebras, you have an axiom. If you take AB, you know that it's supposed to be equal to BA. So we represent this by saying that here in a commutative algebra, you have this. And in a Lie algebra, now we can sort of distinguish them, because Lie algebra, you have the same thing, but with a minus. Also, there are more relations. In a commutative algebra, you have, let's forget about associative, you have really little structure here. But exactly the associative structure that we have tells us what? That if I take first, let's say I take two guys, one and two, I multiply them. So this is multiplication. Here we only have multiplication, so I don't even need to write it. But a priori, we could have more than one operation with two inputs. But for example, the Gerson-Haber algebra. We'll get there. That's a bit more complicated. But so axioms we have for commutative algebras. If I take two guys here and I multiply them, and let's say I multiply them with a third guy. So I use here multiplication again. And then something comes out. I mean, this is associative. So what this means is that it's the same thing as multiplying first the second and the third guy, and then plugging in the first guy, and then getting something, right? In the Lie algebra, you don't have associativity. You have the bad version of associative, or not so nice, which is Jacobi, which tells you something like, if you do this and this and this, but here you put like 1, 2, 3, and then you permute the inputs, and then again you obtain 0. But so what's the whole idea of these operads, this operadic business? You don't care about algebras per se, but you're concerned about operations, right? So this should be called Lie, and then there is also the Gerson-Haber operad. You can also describe it more or less like this. But it's a bit more complicated because now you really have to label things. You have different operations. You have the same axioms like here and here. And then you have some compatibility relation, which is this Leibniz rule, which would give something like, so how do you do it? If you take two things and you multiply them first, and then you use the thing that corresponds to the Lie bracket, then you get the sum of two terms. Well, let's just write the first one. So then it's like you take the second and the third, and then you do a Lie bracket on them. Then you multiply and you get something else. So this would be for Gehr. Gehr is axioms of Lie for Lie bracket, axioms of Kolm for unit, and this. How do you formalize all of this without, so let's avoid to be in the way hand waving stage already. So it's very important, the fact that this is formalized. So we start by defining what say an S module is. An S module M is a sequence of vector spaces. So M.
So here you want to formalize the possibility of permuting elements.
Yes. So exactly. So an S module is some space M with, so essentially you have many MNs, and there is one for each. We call this n-diarity, whatever. What does this mean? with right action, of Sn, the symmetric group on Mn. This is supposed to represent permutation of inputs. So here, say you have the commutative algebra, you have some multiplication. This multiplication is, so this is rigor, this is intuition. The idea is that this mu should be something living in M2. Moreover, mu should have, M2 has some action of S2, S2 is just one transposition, right? And the axiom for commutativity should be saying something that mu acted by 1, 2, so corresponds to, we change the inputs, you obtain mu again. With the Lie algebra, you should still see something in M2, but now acting with 1, 2, you get something different. So the spaces themselves, the M2s, would be the same, but the whole point is that these are the, we're encoding some symmetry with the permutation of variables. So, and this is what is now, at least at this basic level, distinguishing commutative algebras and Lie algebras. Yes. S is the symmetric group. So this S, yeah, this, the whole S is that, I mean, it's a collection. You have many S's, so you say that the whole guy is an S module. And this is my failed attempt of making a math BBS. Good. But now we have to introduce some. I mean, this is not trivial. I mean, this has to be made rigorous, and it still takes a bit of effort. So, what we get. So the whole idea is that to an S module M, we can associate. A functor M tilde from vector spaces to vector spaces, at the very least. So all our structures that we want to encode are algebra, so in particular they should be vector spaces. And by taking M, you construct the functor in the following way. You define M tilde to be on some vector space V, to be the sum of, what kind of sum is this? The sum of M N tensor V to the tensor power N. So for all N bigger than zero. And this tensor product is supposed to be over Sn. Well, what do I mean when I say over Sn? This means actually, so having I want to have a right Sn action that is also compatible with scalars, right? It should commute with the scalar. So in fact, when I write this, I actually mean that all of these guys are right K Sn modules. Right, so right. So whenever I write tensoring over Sn, I'm seeing this as a right KSn module. And what's the Sn left structure here on V? I mean, it's really permuting the elements of V. So if you have V1 tensor V2 living in V tensor power 2, and you apply here 1, 2, I mean, this is exactly what you would expect. This is V2. V1. So I hope I'm convincing you that we're somehow approaching the. Yes?
Suppose you image this thing that you can be where you have some string here and some stuff like that, and you can use
some mobile.
Yeah, so here basically it's doing mobile where you have a mobile tree you can turn, and you can have the one which is green here and green here, so it's symmetric. When you turn it, it's the same guy. But so you could have something which is green here and the red here, so when you turn it, something else. So you have different symmetric actions, and you can decorate it at the bottom with elements of people. So you would like the blue elements of here, such as when you touch here and a bigger blue here, this is compatible to the turn here and the turning of the exchange of the dice here. And that's what is writing here with this M type. The M type is the fact of doing decoration at the bottom of this thing that you're turning, which is compatible with the fact of turning. So when you act by the symmetry on this guy, you want that this is the same, and you prove after or before you want this to be the same, and that's why you also turn the guys at the bottom. So you identify acting of SN here and acting of SN here, and then that's the meaning of tensoring over SN.
And if you have small babies, you can use it to decorate the crate of the baby.
Exactly. Or a Christmas tree, and I would have liked you to do this on 25th of December, wearing the red.
Yeah.
So those to be the same sample.
Yes, Michele?
No. Can we go back to the document? So the thing you wrote on the right side.
Here. So Sn acts here by permutation of variables. So honest permutation, not just intuition in permutation. So the whole idea here is somehow these elements of M are representing operations. And so here, if this was M2, you could have mu, the multiplication. And here, these are representing the things that you're plugging into the operations. Yes, exactly. So this is the whole idea. So this people call this a Schur functor. Whatever, it's supposed to represent exactly this sort of inputs. And then, I mean, then, yes.
So to make things even more precise, so if you have this, let's look at the free operands here, that F common B, right?
Yes.
So you have, for example, M2, so which means for, you wrote for commutative, so let's say for a commutative or for E, you just have one element. So if M2 is generated by one element.
Yes.
And therefore you have a one-dimensional representation of S2, which is either trivial or just sign representation.
Yes.
So if you have associative, then you have generated by two elements and they're trivial.
Yes, exactly. That's the idea. If you have the associative opera, you should have sort of two generators in degree in arity two.
Yeah.
And the symmetric group would permute them. Whereas with the commutative opera or the Lie, you only have one generator, and the action of the symmetric group is sending it either to itself or to minus itself, depending. Yeah. And I mean, the opera, then relations like this should be living in arity 3, so in M3. Good. In commutative, you just have one in arity 3. Yes.
So the relations are.
Yeah, we'll get there. So the idea is, without plugging in vector spaces, you're just thinking of the operations in an abstract way. Putting here this tensor by V, it's like you're putting the, you're already having an algebra structure, which will be somehow V, and this represents the way to putting your elements of the algebra in some sort of operation. So, I mean,
right.
Depending on the kind of algebras you know, you'll realize that, I mean, we're not just concerned of things of degree two. So if you're used to, I don't know, BV algebras, you know that things with one input and one output are also important. But I mean, in any case, the things we're concerned about today are Lie and Gehr. Mainly.
And then bounce on associated remark.
Yes.
What in these three examples give here the show? What do we get for the show functor here? I mean, if we take, for example, for associative, we have.
Yes, but I don't want to do this right away because I. We only know what Lie and Com are in degree one. Especially Lie is very hard to describe in arity. Okay, in degree two, in arity, let's call it arity because we should really make a distinction, because then operads will have some grading also. So we should really be calling this arity, and arity means number of inputs morally. But yeah, so for instance, if you take the commutative operad, whatever that will be, then for the corresponding term of 2, you'll get essentially just
so MN is just one generator.
Yeah, for com you'll get like v2, but since you're tensoring over Sn, this means that you identify this guy and this guy, so you'll get v2 over the equivalence relation, which means that they're the same. And this is what usually people call when you have the symmetric algebra of some vector space, this is what it is. So it's a tensor it's v tensor v modulo AB equals BA.
And in the case of us, there you have two generators, as Constantine
yes.
mentioned. So basically, we would have one generator.
Yes, in the case of us, it's even easy to see what you have in all arities. So since you have absolutely no relations, you get exactly n factorial, some vector space of dimension n factorial, which is all possible ways of, so you can only do multiplications. And it's associative, so you don't care how you parenthesize. So the only question is, how do you put n guys? And you have n factorial ways of doing this. Yes. Yes, we'll get there. We'll certainly get there. That's exactly what I want to get, but probably not today. I mean, I have 15 minutes. I'm just defining. I haven't even defined what an operator is, so probably I need to do another talk or what? Okay, we'll talk about this later. Okay. Yes. So, I mean, if you take two S modules, it's, okay, I motivated this functor, I hope. Now, you can take two S modules and you can sum them. I mean, it's just sum arity by arity, and it's the only thing you need to look at is this S in action, but it acts normally in each component. And as a functor, I mean, you can also see that if you take two things like this and you add them, it's just the same this as the same thing as this. And also, not also, tensor, but with tensor product, things get more subtle. So if I want to define the tensor product of M and N to given S modules, what's the natural thing to do? So you should take, let's define this in arity N. So probably you think, and very correctly, that this should be somehow MI tensor MJ with I plus J equals N. But then the problem is, how does this SN action act here? And it's a priori there is not a very very clear way to put SN acting on this. So what we do is, because here this guy admits an SI action, this guy admits an SJ action, and there is this business of an induced representation, if you know about this, if not, you just tensor with whatever is left to force a tension, an SN action here. So if you have SI and SJ, and by transferring by this, you get a natural SN action. I mean, I didn't really want to enter much into details, but this is important because the whole fact that we have symmetries is a very crucial point in this all this operad business. So, and what else? But now, okay, we can sum them and we can tensor them, and you can see that by making this definition, the module or the you also get this. Also, I mean, from an S module, you can get the functor, but if you could just somehow see the functor, you could also get the S module back by plugging just some k to the power n, you could recover mn. This is not very important, but I'm trying to... But there's one thing that we really want from the functor structure, which is you can compose functors, right? And somehow, in this story, you also want to, the composition is very important because you want to be composing operations. And we need somehow to find some operation at level of S modules that in, so we want some sort of composition like this, such that if you compose the two functors, you get this composition of the modules themselves. So you want something like this. How would you define it? Yeah, I have some space problems. So yes. You define it like this. You take M circ N, and this should be the sum for MKs, and then you tensor with N tensor power K for all K. And you're tensoring over SK. And most of the times, what we'll be doing here is actually composing things that are the same S module, because we want to represent composition inside some opera. But what's the whole idea of this? You have M, it's like you have K inputs of M. You have something here belonging to MK, and you have K legs. And sorry, what's this N? This is supposed to be K. And then in each one of them, you'll sort of put one element of N. So
we don't actually put them, we just put them under.
Yes.
And it's when you will do the multiplication that you will really glue them, right?
Yes, yes. But this sort of represents, and each one of the N's is, I mean, this is an S module, so each one of these guys lives in some arity, so it has some legs itself. So this is the whole idea. If I plug here, I have something k, and let's say this guy has four legs, this guy has three legs, this guy has seven legs, then this whole guy will be living in m circ n in degree the number of legs. So 4 plus 3 plus 7. And we don't care about the k. The k was only to decide how many n's we were inserting, but at the end, the total arity of this whole composition will be the number of legs that we have here. Good, I think. What do I want to do next? No idea. Yes. Exactly. And we get exactly this thing. And by the way, a slight piece of magic is the fact that since we have this equality and the composition of functors is associative, this means also that the composition of S modules is associative with this little circle. Oh. Now it's fine. Now everyone knows what's Concevich formality. I hope. Maybe not. And now we can define what an operator is. If you like this sort of stuff, with this composition, the S modules form a monoidal category. So definition. Symmetric operad P, so the whole symmetric is this S module thing. P, which is what you use to represent some P with some gamma and some eta, is an S module. P with gamma, which is something from P sort of composed with P to P, which is what we call the composition map. And the fact that operads should have some unit. You can, if you have some composition, you can compose things by doing nothing, but this corresponds to putting in the identity in some operation. So you have eta from I, where I is just some DS module that is I of k is equal to zero if k is different from one, and I of one is just a one-dimensional vector space. We don't need to specify the action of S1 because S1 is trivial. And some action, something from here to there. This is not very important. This is just the fact that there is some identity. But this is the important thing. It's a composition map. And this represents exactly the fact that you're composing operations, whether it be multiplication with itself or in Gerstenhaber multiplication with some Lie bracket. The important thing is that a priori mu and Lie bracket are guys, each one of them is living in P, but when you put mu inside Lie bracket, this doesn't live a priori in P. This lives in P circ P. But this is supposed to be an operation in the whole in the operad. So you actually. Yes. So say now I'm taking here m and n to be the same. So it's like I put this here. So in this sort of tree representation, this is like I first take the Lie bracket, and then I put in, and then it's before I do this multiplication, like this. And here I don't, and exactly, and the point is that here I'm not doing anything in this slot, but in my definition of composition, I have to plug in something, and that's why I require an identity. Here, it's just an identity. Here, this is bracket. Here, this is mu. And in an abstract way, this lives here. But I want this to be an operation in P. And so that's why I require this composition map. It takes something here and tells me that, in fact, this is something an operation in our operad. So
you have examples
things that are almost like that but do not have the composition.
That are almost like that. So S modules that are.
You can stack things, but you cannot compose them. It seems to me like.
That they exist or that they are not constantly.
Well, that this is the right thing you have to do, right? But the fact that you need an axiom.
Oh, because here it does. You don't know yet who is the image of this by the composition.
Yeah.
Here, just the ingredients before doing the machine model.
So I guess both have to be as more and more this over.
Yes.
The three operator identified by S module. That's what you do. When you just have like that.
Yes. Exactly. So that's what I mean. This is a space, and a priori, this is this strange definition. Strange, I mean, this is this definition. So it's sort of you chose guys in P, three guys in P, and now we're saying this composition map tells you exactly what happens when you put them together like this. And of course, then the composition map should be sort of associative. So let me just write one axiom for you to see what's required. But so you know what I'm going to write, right?
I guess it's great to do the case of associative algebras. If you just do the stacking like that without giving relation, you get the operator of magma. You know, magma is just when you create things by parenthesizing. But if you really want to encode associative algebras, if you do that and
okay,
it's
encoded
that,
in this composition.
Exactly. It's encoded in the gamma. It's really in the gamma.
Yes, exactly. So the whole point is that. Okay, two things. A good example should be maybe the Lie operat. But Lie has two different properties. Lie, for instance, has on one hand you have anti-symmetry. Anti-symmetry does not come from any composition. Anti-symmetry just means that if you take the Lie bracket, you permute the inputs, you get the negative thing, the symmetric thing. And then there is Jacobi. Yes, this is encoded in the SN module structure. So this is very important. However, the fact that you have Jacobi means that you have some composition of Lie brackets, and so this is encoded in the composition map. You see? So
the relations, the extra relations are here.
Exactly. 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 So and then you have like. Yes, a priori, before the composition map, the only thing you know is that they are vector spaces and you have some permutation of variables. But now, exactly. So you want to encode the fact that you have what relations come from composition of operations. So in the case of the associative algebra or commutative or whatever, the associativity will come from here, but the commutativity will come from the SN, the action of S2, of the permutation of the inputs. Got it?
Yes.
And okay, and we require, so we saw that this with parentheses in different places, it's the same thing, and we just require that the composition in different ways will be, is the same. Hope this is clear. This is usually a pentagon, but I draw it as a square. So let's just, because one is like parentheses like here and the other one is parentheses on the other way around, because they're not equal, they're naturally isomorphic, right? Whatever. The whole identity map means that you can put an identity. Okay, I can also put the axiom for this, it's stupid. You put I, you send I to P, and then you send P back to Y, and you get the identity from. Okay, that's this, right? Ah, no, but But also there is the, I mean, what's this map? I didn't even define this map. I'm saying nonsense. The whole point is that if you compose the identity, you take, so this is some operation living in P. If you put the identity here, so let's call it the identity of P, which is the, let's say, the generator of this I1, and you use the composition map, gamma, so here it's also always gamma, and you send it to P, it's supposed to be, what am I saying? Because, okay, sorry, here you can go to P, so from this you use eta composed with the identity, so you do nothing to the second component, you go from P to P, and from here, yeah, right, because there is no, the composition map is not defined from here to here, it's defined from here to here. And, I mean, this, you can check that I is just an identity for this composition. I mean, it's very clear from the formula that if you put something here that only exists in array T1, then you will obtain n back again, because the only possibility is to have k equals 1, because otherwise it will always be 0. Yeah, the fact, yes, no, I'm just saying that this map is sort of the equality map, because this can be naturally identified with this. So one axiom is this, and then there is also the other axiom. So if instead you take P and you plug identity everywhere, you're not doing anything. So notice that this product, this composition map, is something very, very non-symmetric. So it makes a big difference. You can see immediately just with the identity. Here, if I do this, it's like putting just one identity before, above the operation, whereas doing this means I'm putting many identities. Yeah, good. And yes. Here, I'm just saying that this should commute. Here, I'm saying it's equality, identification. Because of, I'm just saying, E composed with P is naturally isomorphic to P. And this equal is this natural isomorphism that I'm doing here. So maybe let's take an arrow and put a big equal. And I don't know, it's already past the time, so.
But maybe you can just
yes, maybe I can. Maybe I can just define what an algebra over an operad is. And I mean, I really don't like to go over time, and I'm already 5 minutes over time. But so, just to give the idea, because, yeah, but lunch, yes, so, definition, why am I? Definition, let A be a vector space. Why are we calling it A? Because we say that A is an algebra over P, an operad. If we're given, if we have a map like gamma A from P A to A. I mean, P A is what I defined before with the S module, and I mean, it's the same definition that I gave for actually P circ A. And what does this mean? This means that what's an algebra? It's something that I give you some set of operations, and I tell you how do these operations act on A. So, like a commutative algebra is, I mean, I have to decide what's the multiplication of A and B, and this is the data of a commutative algebra, and then then there is also the.
So you mean that you can formally write new AD, so that would be what is.
Yes.
But this, if you have read algebra, this should be something specific.
Yeah, this should correspond to some element that belongs to A. So what I say is that a priori, I mean, I'm writing it like this, but in fact, this we write it like this, but in fact, we're writing it as something living here and here. It's a priori something abstract.
Or like, for example, for the SN2 Lie algebra, you have generators E, F, G. You can always write a bracket,
yes.
F, but you don't know when. And the information of defining the SN2 is when you say E, F equals H.
Yes, exactly. So this is the information, for instance, what is the Lie bracket of I and J or something.
So this is I take from here, like the operation and some tuple I want to apply the operation.
To evaluate, yes.
And then I do evaluation.
Exactly. And then I mean there is something very natural to require because circle. Shit. Okay. Yeah, so the idea is I take some operation and elements of the, yeah, so.
Oh, and you see that finally the Lie vector space is a module where you could just use zero.
So the idea is I want to make sense out of this. But if I choose something living here, in fact, I'm writing this, but what I should be writing is some element living here and here. So what I should be writing is mu, our operation living in P. So this lives in P. Now tensor. A tense P. But this element that comes here is somehow distinguished. So usually instead of putting a tensor product here, people put, they write it like this. But the idea is that we want this to represent this element. So that's why we have a map from this to whatever it's supposed to give. And now we have, I mean, we have two sorts of composition of things in the operad with the algebra, which is this, and you have the composition map from the operad that composes abstractly two operations, and we want them to be compatible in the natural sense. So if you take PPA, you can either compose these two guys together, and you get something in P. So by using gamma circ doing the identity on A. Or you can do, or you can use this gamma A. So you do nothing on P, and you do gamma A. And here you obtain P circ A. So then, if you do gamma A on both sides, you get A back again. And there is also some unit condition that is important. But yes. A reasonable exercise. Yes, I would like to do some examples. Of course, I'm not going to do anything today. Maybe we can finish the talk and we can talk about this just when the thing is over. So thank you. Turn off the camera. Well, yes, of course, it should be a pentagon.